did join the Air Force and serve our nation. He has an amazing story, and we're going to recount and celebrate some of that story today. Military retirement ceremonies are important on at least three levels. On one level, they're important because we honor the profession, the heritage of the profession of arms. They're one of the things that the military does that sets us apart from the civilian world. We make a really big deal about our quarter century of service to our nation. In addition to honoring the heritage of the profession of arms, we honor the family. The service member serves, families also serve. They also sacrifice. So, Vaso, Susan, we thank you for your encouragement and support of faith along the way. And besides honoring the heritage of the profession of arms and honoring the family members, of course, we honor the retired service member. And I said we'd recount his story. I'll start with a brief overview of his chronology, assignments, and of course, how that program as well. Make a few comments on each and then draw some themes that I see for the 24 of our years. Sir Armstrong's had an amazing list of great places to be stationed from my point of view. After a basic at Lackland, of course, starting out at McCord Air Force Base in Washington State, very popular location. And there he served in information management, IM, as well as an orderly room. After McCord, he took a hardship tour to Hawaii, serving at Camp Smith and Hickam Air Force Base. And there he performed in a number of capacities, especially the executive support staff and the front office for senior leaders. And this starts a trend in his career of tending to be in that front office, which is also important because, which is very important because they're the kinds of things that affect people's lives. Awards and decks go through a front office, performance reports, promotion recommendations, suspenses to keep the unit out of trouble, all those things absolutely positively must be done right or nothing else does right. And so commanders tend to pick people to be in those places that they know will get the job done right without needing a lot of detailed day-to-day guidance. People who can operate well with mission high orders. So Camp Smith and Hickam, the executive support staff, starts that trend of very important work. And then to Colorado Springs, quite a few years in the Cheyenne Mountain Command Center, as well as at Peterson Air Force Base, serving once again in IM, the group command staff, continuation of that trend, knowledge operations, and this had to be fascinating and important. He was a missile warning systems tester for our nation. After Colorado Springs, a good long run there, he moved over to the Mine Air Operations Center 7 in Lagos, Greece, a NATO assignment where we were able to serve together, and we'll talk more about that in a minute, but there he was sort of a one-person front office, orderly room, command, support staff, travel arranger, and liaison with the host nation, and he did it all very, very well. It was a good assignment for us all. After NATO, he stayed and took that part of the world after NATO assignment was used at the Rogers Air Base in Portugal, and there he was the superintendent of the Wing Inspector General Office. And that is a prime position. He says he's most proud of his accomplishment in his career. And that's well said, because that was an opportunity to not only improve the mission, the performance of the wing through the inspection program, but also the quality of life for the airmen and families at that point. Now, I should say that he may be most proud of his time at Lodges. He considers his best assignment, the KOC 7, for a number of reasons, probably, but mostly because he met Boston there. So that was on. And I can see why. After Lodges, of course, coming here to Fort Meade and so the distinguished 24 years of service. I said he had a reputation for excellence in those front office positions. I do see three overall themes in his career, though. And the first is make it better. Wherever he was, whatever process he was a part of, or operation, or unit, he was always improving the system. I extracted some verbs from his many performance reports, and the verbs include revamped, wrote, trained, constructed, led, designed and maintained, organized, executed, revitalized. There's nothing status quo about this professional. He's always on the move, lots of energy, making things better. And that's important, especially for those of you still in uniform. I ask you to take note. We join the military, and we think it's our Air Force, it's our Army. That's only partly true. We're actually just stewards of the service for a fairly short period of time. We joined the military that someone else provided for us, took care of. We're with it for 20, maybe 30 years, if we're lucky, and then we hand it off to the next generation. So in that finite period, it's really our job not just to keep the train running on time, but to much better improve it, and certainly we do that in a very wholehearted fashion. I have one brief anecdote about improving processes and making things run better. I mentioned we had a good time serving in a NATO in my air operations center and the command and control facility. NATO is a wonderful alliance. It's been great for all the member nations, but it's not known for its administrative agility. There's a reason that people joke that NATO actually stands for no action, talk, or action. It's not quite true, but administratively it's sort of kind of true. So I mentioned he was a one-man travel office, and seemingly, whenever we have to travel, the requirement would come about midday Friday morning. Well, late Friday morning and in the afternoon is not the time to try to get things done in NATO. Sometimes it just has to happen. And in our rather complex bureaucracy, any travel approval had to go, no matter who it was, all the way up to our boss, the Green Three-Star General. Getting that done on Friday afternoon was a very profound challenge. However, he was just the NCO to make it happen, and I never wanted to be between him and his objective. So I don't know if he actually approved the process, but he always got the job done. He always got the travel approval. The Three-Star always said yes, even if it was Friday afternoon in NATO. So a job well done there. But the theme certainly is making everything better. Beyond that, another theme about Sergeant Armstrong was helping others. He was always looking out for what are other people he could help, whose lives he could improve. A consistent theme in his reports through the years was volunteer in the community to mentor at-risk youth, to teach self-defense classes. And I think you'd argue with me, you wouldn't argue with me, he has a lot of credibility in the self-defense realm. Teach self-defense classes, help junior airmen, and so forth. Always helping the other person, not just looking out for himself. And he actually got quite a few outstanding volunteer service medals. This is just one of them. I'll read a couple of words to give you a sense that this was not just some feel-good program on his part. He did a lot of good things to help people out, spend a lot of time. Brief description in this case, founded a martial arts mentoring program for at-risk youth ages 12 to 19, assigned to juvenile detention facilities. These young men are living in group or foster homes. Continued dedicated contributions to the local community. Developed a mentorship program, average of 12 hours a week, many success stories, providing mentorship to over 30 young men during the reporting period. Pillar in our community, providing free women's self-defense classes and free children's self-awareness seminars. Armstrong's volunteer acts have been recognized by Peterson Air Force Base, Rewood Air Force Base, Headquarters Air Force Base Command, and the local community. So you get a feel for it. In addition to working very, very hard on the job, off duty, he was making life better for a lot of people who were there and helping the next person over the fence. In addition to helping others, I think this is the fun thing of it all. He has, throughout hard work, throughout volunteer work, a flair, a flamboyance, a zest for life, for Zoe, that is just irrepressible. He lights up any room he comes into, and you know, whether it's his email greetings, his in-person greetings, his clothes, often his cars, every day's a party with this guy. And I say that not in terms of someone who didn't do any work, but a guy who did a lot of work and still had a party every day, and therefore just enriched the lives of those around him. The guy makes a statement. A quick story there, back to Greece, a great assignment. I would say traffic in Greece is a little bit like DC, somewhat chaotic, somewhat every man for himself. And so most of those of us who are Americans over there walk kind of deep, cars that get us made the green line, we have a little fender bend and so forth. But not Sergeant Armstrong. Now, he did moderate a little bit. Mercedes-Benz stayed back in the States, the customized Mercedes-Benz, not just the Benz. But he got himself this Audi TT convertible. Of course, it was in the process of customization over a couple of years as well. And he looked fantastic in it. The clothes, the customized TT convertible, the Greek sun. It was another fashion statement for sure. He looked great in it, and he looked great out of it. What I never actually figured out, this is a big guy, right? And the TT is a little car. I never quite figured out how he got into it, or how he got out. I never actually saw that process happen. I only have to assume that it involved double employees. A flamboyance that just lights up everything. So well done. Convince the hard work instead of hard work. Now, so Sergeant Schroeder alluded to this, but yeah, we're going to have a retirement ceremony. We're going to read your retirement orders, but the military's not quite done with you yet, okay? There's a little fine print that we don't actually read out loud in retirement ceremonies. Figure your fine print. And the first is, take your strong suits, your characteristics that drive to improve, to help others, to lighten up the union, and take it into the civilian community. I know you and Vasco are headed to Crete. The Greek civilian world needs these strong suits that you have, so does the United States. So don't lose that. Keep your edge. The civilian world needs your ready influence. That's charge number one as a retired military person. And then charge number two is, and we've already said this, you're still an ambassador for the military. You're kind of a recruiter emeritus. So tell your story, and tell it in a way that makes young people be like, I want to join that winning team too. I don't want to miss out. So it's not, well, what did you do? Well, I was in the military for 24 years. I haven't worked on computers. It was amazing. I had the most incredible experiences. Let me tell you about the time that, and you will do this very well. The youngsters line up. But seriously, we're still ambassadors. We're still recruiters for the military services. Tell the story with your typical energy. Well, I started out by saying, quote of Sergeant Armstrong, if I didn't join the Air Force, I'd probably be dead. He said that seriously, but fortunately, he did join. He did make a tremendous contribution over 24 years. You have left the Air Force considerably better than you found it. You've enriched the lives of everyone who's had the privilege of serving you. So you've done well in that phase of life. You'll do well in the next. Good luck and Godspeed.
Demonstrated outstanding technical expertise and knowledge by successfully completing the SharePoint 2013 migration 1 month ahead of the major command's target date. The skillful direction empowered unit members with the means to develop 10 SharePoint pages, streamlining a one-stop collaboration link to the field. In addition, as the cybersecurity liaison and information system security officer, Sergeant Armstrong provided vital information authorizing the use of 25 external hard disk drives, which maintain access to critical mission data. Finally, he coordinated the compact disk burner and data loss prevention software update, allowing the transfer of critical data with no interruption to mission success. The singularly distinctive accomplishments of Sergeant Armstrong culminate a distinguished career in the service of his country and reflect great credit upon him and the United States Air Force. Signed, David B. Bosco, Colonel, U.S. Air Force, Commander, Air Force Spectrum Management Office. Thank you, sir. Senior Airman Hayden Bevel will now read the poem entitled The Watch.
For 24 years, this airman has stood the watch. While some of us were in our beds at night, this airman stood the watch. While some of us were in school learning our trade, this airman stood the watch. Yes, even before some of us were born into this world, this airman stood the watch. In those years when the storm clouds of war were seen brewing on the horizon of history, this airman stood the watch. Many times, he would cast an eye ashore and see his family standing there, needing his guidance and help, needing that hand to hold during those hard times, but he still stood the watch. stood the watch for 24 years. He stood the watch so that we, our families, and our fellow countrymen could sleep soundly in safety each and every night, knowing that an airman stood the watch. Today we are here to say, Master Sergeant David Armstrong, the watch stands relieved. Relieved by those you have led, guided, and trained. You stand relieved. We have the watch.
Thank you, Sergeant Mandel. Well, ladies and gentlemen, Major General Graver will now retire Master Sergeant Armstrong.
Please. What was the orders?
Attention to orders. Department of the Air Force, Washington, D.C., Special Order Number 8C009059, Master Sergeant David M. Armstrong, effective 28 February 2017. You are relieved from active duty, Air Force Spectrum Management Office, Fort George G. Meade, Maryland. Retired effective 1 March 2017, per AFI 36-3203 and the grade of Master Sergeant. Ladies and gentlemen, please be seated. Major General Graver will now present the certificate of retirement and the presidential certificate of appreciation to Master Sergeant Armstrong. Every person retiring from active duty is presented with a certificate of retirement to commemorate their active duty career. The certificate reads, Certificate of Retirement from the Armed Forces of the United States of America. To all who shall see these present readings, this is to certify that Master Sergeant David M. Armstrong, having served faithfully and honorably, was retired from the United States Air Force on the 28th day of February 2017. Signed, General L. Goldfing, Chief of Staff, the United States Air Force. Master Sergeant David M. Armstrong will also receive the Presidential Certificate. We are pleased to present you with this Presidential Certificate of Appreciation. The certificate reads, the Certificate of Appreciation for Service in the Armed Forces of the United States of America. Master Sergeant David M. Armstrong, I extend to you my personal thanks and the sincere appreciation of a grateful nation for your contribution of honorable service to our country. You have helped maintain the security of the nation during a critical time in its history. With a devotion to duty and a spirit of sacrifice in keeping with the proud traditions of military service, your commitment and dedication have been an inspiration for those who follow in your footsteps and for all Americans who join me today in saluting you for a job extremely well done. My best wishes to you for happiness and success in the future, signed Barack Obama, Commander-in-Chief.
You should be clapping. Certificate
of appreciation from the Chief Master Sergeant of the Air Force. I am proud to join your friends and family in congratulating you on your retirement from the United States Air Force, Master Sergeant David M. Armstrong. The achievements and contributions you have made throughout your career are indicative of the core values of our great service. Your retirement is well deserved, but your selfless contributions will be sorely missed. On behalf of all airmen, thank you for your faithful and devoted service to our nation. As this chapter in your life closes and a new one begins, I hope the years ahead are filled with more great memories and continued success. Signed, Chief Master Sergeant of the Air Force, James A. Cody. And your husband up front to place the pin on Sergeant Armstrong's lapel, symbolizing his transition from active duty to retired status.
Thank you.
paper will now present you with an Air Force Certificate of Appreciation for the support you have given your husband throughout his career. The certificate reads, Certificate of Appreciation from the United States Air Force. In grateful appreciation, the United States Air Force presents the Certificate of Recognition to Vasiliki Lapa Armstrong for the commitment and numerous contributions that made positive impacts to the nation's defense. Thank you for the support which gave strength and purpose to your spouse's service. Given on the 28th day of February 2017, signed General David Goldfein, Chief of Staff, United States Air Force. Sergeant of the Air Force. On behalf of all Air Force airmen and their families, the Chief Master Sergeant of the Air Force presents the Certificate of Appreciation to Ms. Vasiliki Lapa Armstrong. I join your spouse, family, and friends in thanking you for the numerous contributions and sacrifices you made in support of our United States Air Force. Your dedication gave strength and purpose to your spouse's service in defense of our nation. Signed, Chief Master Sergeant of the Air Force, James A. Cody. At this time, Colonel Bosco would like to make a special presentation to Master Sergeant Armstrong on behalf of the Air Force Spectrum Management Office. Colonel Bosco,
the floor is yours. Thank you, Sergeant Schroeder. As is tradition, the military member is deserved a shadow box. Old Navy tradition the Air Force stole. And before I show it to you, a lot of work went into this thing. So when you get a chance, swing by, take a look at it. I'm back on the table since you won't be able to see the detail from your seats. But on behalf of ASMO, I want to present this bit of wood and metal to you because it means so much more than what is in it. It is the concept behind it. And I'm going to turn it up here so everybody can take a look see at it. 24 years in the making. Some beautiful things in here. So when you get a chance, please take a look on behalf of ASMO. Thank you so much for your service.
Martial arts and stuff like that. He says he can fight, but I beat him up before. He'll never admit that. You know? It was actually a funny story. I had him at the bottom of the restaurant with my sweat dropped in his face, and he got him like a diva. I'm done. I'm like, real man, real man. So, but when I think about, well, I'm not going to call you Master Sergeant all the entire time up here. For me, he's just a. I can talk about his career and all this other things, but when I'm up here, I'm just going to talk about my best friend. I'm be honest, if it was somebody else and they asked me to come every time, I'm like, oh, man, you know, I'm not paying $500 for a ticket for Wichita, Kansas to come here. But when I think about him, I think about all the things that does not go into EPR, that does not, you know, that doesn't detail or is not a reflection of the shadow box. I think about the loyalty, I think about the friendship, I think about the kind words that so many people who are in this position do not take the time to do. They don't take that time to care about someone. So Sergeant Armstrong and I, we met in Lodgesville, and I was down, I was out. I mean, he will attest to it, facing 30 years in prison for something that should have never gone, that most people believe should have never gone to court. Depressing, very suicidal, things like that. Then all of a sudden, I meet Sergeant Armstrong. I don't know why he reached out to me. There was other people trying to, but he made sure that he reached out to me. And funny thing is, he never brought up anything. We just lived life, took me out, got to know him pretty well. And he was never judgmental. He never came to a conclusion about me. He just, you know, this is who I am. I don't care what happened or what you're accused of. This is the direction I'm going to be your friend without actually saying those words directly. So, fast forward, everything is pushed off just as expected, and we go to Greece. I would talk about Greece, but I don't remember anything. I mean, but you're talking about 2 weeks of just partying. I mean, got up at noon, coffee, the drinks, 5 o'clock more drinks. I'm gonna buy more drinks. 2:30 in the morning, more drinks, and yeah, that's thanks, Bob. You know, what's calling? Yeah. But while I was there, something clicked in my head about the type of person he really is, because it was myself and so many other friends. And I realized, how do you know him? And how do you know him? And then we just come together, and I realized Colin, Mike, myself, and there were others. He always found these people when they were down. And so it was like he knew how, he has this way of finding someone and pulling them out of that hole when people in the church are not there, when they're supposed to, and all these other friends who say they're your friends don't know where to be found. And I just thought that was remarkable because that's not something you have to do. The rank of Master Sergeant doesn't require you to do that. Well, you know, even as a human being, you don't have to. You know, a lot of times we get confused, and then this is something I will never forget. You know, I remember him telling me, don't ever get confused about your problems and other people, because people don't have to care. It's not their problem. So that made me realize when a person does care, when they're praying for you, when they're talking to you, just remember that person, because they don't have to be there. You know, how many times do people go out their way, especially in D.C., just to say good morning? I mean, the way he treated me while I was there, I wish people would treat each other like that all the time. Love you too. Yeah. So my tour at Lodges came to an end, but I knew off of one thing that our friendship would never end. Did anyone know David's religious? I'm lying, he's not. Not at all. But this is how you know a friend is special. When they do something that's out of their character, just for you. So he calls me before the judgment is made, and he says, I don't know if he actually did it, but this touched me to this day because this is so not him. I used to try to get him to come to church all the time. And he'd be like, yeah, what time to start? Yeah, I'm here. Bob said, yeah, I'm here. And then I face he does. So, but he called me the day before the judgment. He says, truth, brother, I don't do this. I don't bring it into the God church thing. And I usually don't pray. But for you. So I knew from then that we'll always be friends. And so many things I learned from him that I use now. So when my airmen look at me and they say, why, you know, thank you for being for me during this hard time where I got an Article 15 or my wife left me or whatever the case may be. And I just tell them, you know, if I had to pinpoint one person that's responsible for me still being alive, I always talk about Master Armstrong. They don't know him, they see the pictures, but I thank him. And so, get back to that story at the beginning. I was that person drowning. Woke up, thought I was in heaven. All thing I see is a a guy with two bottles in his hands.
Let's party, dude!
So, congratulations on your 24 years of service. And when I make tech next year, I'll be thinking about you. When I become a master sergeant, I'll think about you. When I become a first sergeant, to continue to help out airmen the way you help me, I'll be thinking about you. Thank you.
Jokingly, I hope, Supreme Leader. I knew him first many years ago in Colorado Springs at Sensei Dave. As was mentioned, he was part of a mentoring program for at-risk youth involved in the juvenile system. Now, I'm honored to call him a friend. I met Dave at a very troubled time in my life. In and out of juvie, I was in a foster home. And he was a mentor who taught Okinawa Kenpo Karate. I thought it would be fun to learn to beat people up. He had very different lessons in mind for me. My childhood was not necessarily ideal, and I was at a crossroad in my life at this point. One path lay in more trouble, jail time, and the possibility that I would not even make it to my 21st birthday. Down the other lay a choice to be a better person and do what I could to give back to the people around me in the community. Through his interactions with me, he helped me to choose the latter path. Dave personified, and still personifies, the quote, "Be the positive change you want to see in the world." Leading by example, he taught the value of discipline. I would often become quite well acquainted with the mats of the dojo, often at high speed, after I had made less than stellar choices. Hard work and attention to detail was also something that he preached and demonstrated. You did it until you got it right, and then you did it 10 more times until you couldn't get it wrong. But he also showed the importance of many other traits: kindness, acceptance, openness, and caring. I had a confidant, a moral compass. I would always have a guiding hand. He made himself available day or night to help me and teens like me. As I've grown older, my relationship with Dave has changed. Now, we're friends and equals as adults. But that doesn't mean that I've lost my sensei. Because whenever I need to bounce an idea off of him, ask him a question, he's always available. Even when he was halfway around the world in Greece. I always know that I can ask for help and have someone to celebrate good things in my life. He is, and I hope always will be, a very large part of my life. And I can honestly say that his influence and lessons helped me not only become a productive member of society, but a better person as a whole. For the entire time I've known him, Master Sergeant Armstrong has been a credit to himself, to those he serves with, and to the Air Force as a whole. Sensei, you deserve a happy, long-lasting, and fulfilling retirement.
General, I
find out that Dave and I have a lot in common in terms of our careers and the path that we chose to serve the country. But today, I just want to talk to you about how Dave came into my life and the impact that he made, not only for me, but for others, especially veterans. I've known Dave for quite some time, and about 6 months ago, we finally got a chance to sit down on a boat during the summer and had a nice chat. I am also the executive director of a nonprofit organization called Lift the Vet. And so what my organization does is to advocate for services and benefits of veterans. Matt Sergeant Armstrong identified a problem that I was having with an outreach program for veterans in Puerto Rico. I was trying to get motorized wheelchairs to veterans in Puerto Rico that were otherwise not eligible to get it from the VA. He took the initiative to contact a friend in South Carolina. And long story short, what happened was the Air Force provided a C-17 aircraft for me to take the wheelchairs to Puerto Rico. And so I'm very grateful to Master Sergeant Armstrong and the lives of the veterans that he touched through my organization. And for that, I will forever be very grateful. And so I'll keep it short, and also as commissioner, on behalf of the governor, the Honorable Larry Hogan, I want to congratulate you on your retirement. Thank you very much.
Good evening, everyone. My name is Tyrone Hurley. I am one of Master Sergeant Armstrong's co-workers at DISA. So, and clearly as you see through the video recording service. So, I am probably the person that knows David the least. I met him after he came back from Greece, and actually when I met him, I didn't even know he was at DISA. I met him at a car show. As you know, somebody generally loves his cars, and I love my cars too. So it just so happened to be ironic that not only did we work in the same agency, but we worked in the same building, just not on the same floor, but practically doing the same thing. So why am I up here? I'm a product of, I like to call myself a product of positive energy. I'm a product of my parents who have raised me well. I'm a product of my uncles who I adore, ironically, one being retired Marine Corps and one being retired Air Force. And in that irony, there are two people in recent weeks, say months, who have actually touched me very dearly, one being a retired Marine Corps Lance Corporal and Master Sergeant Armstrong. So why am I up here? Pretty much to tell Dave how much he means to me, even though I'm probably the person that knows him the least. Next week, actually, the day after Thanksgiving, will be exactly 2 months to the day that I lost my mother. My mother had stage 4 breast cancer, and it's a hard thing to watch your mother deteriorate and then eventually pass on. You know, a lot of people always say, hey, if you need me, I'm there. You know, if you need anything, let me know. They reach out to you. It's, you know, and it's all with good intentions. But there's only two people who said, I need you to come here, and we need to go through this. And that's retired Lance Corporal Brad Fletcher, United States Marine Corps, and soon to be, as we leave here, retired Master Sergeant David Armstrong. And there's something about good camaraderie in Starbucks. So when I talk to people outside of my family, they ask me how I'm doing. I said, you know, I'm okay. I'm dealing with it. You know, taking it day by day. You know, I'm okay. You know, God is moving me and my family. And I kind of keep it at that. You know, because you don't want to push off people who actually want, who actually are concerned. But of all these people, when Dave and Brad, you know, called me out and said, hey, you know, we got to talk about this. And as soon as they said, are you okay? I mean, it came out like a flood. Everything just came out like a flood. How hurt I was, how upset I was, how mad I was at the whole entire situation. And it was such an amazing thing to me to say, I barely know this guy. I mean, there, every one of you could be up here and tell a much better and longer story than I have. But this is a testament to the kind of person he is. Not just the kind of airman in service to the military, but just the genuine kind of person he is. And I cannot thank you enough. You came at the right time. And no matter where you are in the world, here, Greece, or wherever, whenever you need me, brother, I will be there. Hella hot water. So thank you. And thank you, everyone.
Female, as well as maybe somewhat civilian perspective of why Dave is amazing. I think I met Dave approximately a year ago, and we met in a social environment in Baltimore for our love of all things salsa, all things Latin, and we immediately connected. We talked about everything, and as we got to know each other a little bit better, he let me know, hey, I thought you would be down to earth. I thought you might be a little bit snobby. And I thought to myself, that's unfortunate. But how nice if that's the perspective I gave for this guy to continue to keep talking to me. And we are like the best of friends. At least he's the best of friends to me. He's a big brother. And as an older sibling, I don't have anything that's larger or bigger or more powerful than I am. He's very real. But he keeps you grounded. So no matter what it is that you're trying to aspire to, he encourages you to stay connected with family, stay connected with friends, make time to go on vacation, make time to see the world. And I think I needed that. I'm a workaholic, and I love it, but it's great to have someone remind you, hey, what's going on? Is everything okay? How's your day? How's your family? And make you open up, make you be a real person. And that's something that's slightly far removed. So I look forward to finding a reason to take vacations, real vacations, go see him in Bosco and Greece, and continue to expand our friendship and our connection. So I wish you well on your retirement. You will be missed leaving the Mid-Atlantic.
Determined that the flag of the United States be 13 stripes, alternating between 7 red,
and 6 white. And that the Union be 13 stars, white and a blue veil represent a new constellation. Between 1777 and 1960, the shape and the design of the flag evolved into the flag presented before you today. The 13 horizontal stripes present the original 13 colonies, while the stars represent the 50 states of the Union. The colors of the flag are symbolic as well. Red symbolizes hardiness and valor, white signifies purity and innocence, and blue represents vigilance, perseverance, and justice. Traditionally, a symbol of liberty, the American flag has carried a message of freedom and inspired Americans both at home and abroad. In 1814, Francis Scott Key was so moved at seeing the stars and stripes waving after the British shelling of Baltimore's Fort McHenry that he wrote the words to the Star Spangled Banner. In 1892, the flag inspired Francis Bellamy to write the Pledge of Allegiance, our most famous flag salute and patriotic oath. In July 1969, the American flag was flown into space when Neil Armstrong planted it on the surface of the moon. Today, our flag signifies constellations of Air Force satellites that circle our globe, and on the thin flash of our aircraft in harm's way in every corner of the world. Indeed, it flies in the hearts of every airman and serves our great nation. The sun never sets on our Air Force, nor on the flag we so proudly cherish. Since 1776, no generation of Americans has been spared the responsibility of defending the freedom. Today's airmen remain committed to preserving the freedom that others won for us for generations to come. By displaying the flag and giving it a distinctive hold, we show respect to the flag and express our gratitude to those individuals who fought and continue to fight for freedom at home and abroad. Since the dawn of the 20th century, airmen have proudly flown the flag in every major conflict on lands and skies around the world. It is their responsibility, our responsibility, to continue to protect and preserve the rights, privileges, and freedoms that we as Americans enjoy today. The United States flag represents who we are. It stands for the freedom we all share and the pride and patriotism we feel for our country. We cherish its legacy as a beacon of hope to one and all. Long may it wave.
You know how much it means to me.
and I didn't ask you. You told me you were coming. And then you told me you were going to speak. And I got nervous. Gosh, Bryce, Susie, you guys drove. These guys drove since 4 this morning. Did you guys get on the road? 5 this morning. Susie got off at 4 yesterday afternoon. They're both EMT, paramedics. Bryce just got off of work, got into a car, and then came. So he's operating on zero sleep just to be here. Besides your words, besides the connection, besides what I've done for you and you've done for me, thank you for doing that. I appreciate it. My Puerto Rican brother, no, sir. thank you. For just coming and doing this, you guys. I wish we had more time to connect and be friends. But I appreciate you, and I appreciate being able to be a facilitator in your endeavors. Without credit, just because it's the right thing. Waseca, this is my workaholic friend. If she has time just to say hi, it's just a smile on my face. But I'm glad that we've been able to connect, and I know you're going to come visit me in the Basiliki in Greece. I'm sure of it. Susie Q, my daughter, who my wife gladly passed the flag to. She's like, I don't know what to do with this. She's not. And for those of you that don't know, Vaso, my wife, is Greek, so she's like, this is American, can I touch it? I don't know. It's not a Greek flag, I don't know what to do with a Greek flag. Okay. Susan, you've been there for 24 years. Well, for 21 years. She's not quite 24. But you've been there, and you've been without me when I deployed to Italy. That really did happen. I don't know if you saw that, sir. My one deployment, I didn't get out of any deployments, but my one deployment was to Italy.
It was a hardship.
It was a hardship. As a matter of fact, I did it twice. I took two consecutive hardship tours to Italy. Susan, I love you. And I'm so proud of you. You've become so successful. And my son that's in the Air Force, David, can't be here today. He's in Alaska and about to PCS. But I'm proud of him, and I'm thankful that he's been there and has suffered through or has been a support throughout my 24 years. Vasiliki, my darling wife, who I'm going all the way back to Greece for, I love you so much. And I'm so glad, sweetheart, that we're closing one chapter and opening up a different chapter that's going to be equally, if not more, amazing. And I'm glad that you're part of that. Are you going to cry? I'm trying to make you cry. So I do have something written. I almost am speechless with the things that you guys have said about me. I really am. I try to go through life making an impact in whatever it is. If it's work, if it's something that I'm doing, if it's my car, if it's my clothes, if it's the people around me, I want to make sure that I don't just walk through life, that I actually take the moment and the opportunity to live life. Greece has just personified that for me. Greece and its culture and my wife have just put that in bigger perspective. But I'm glad that I've had the opportunity to go through this life, because as Major General Graper said, if it wasn't for the Air Force, I'd have been selling drugs in LA, and I was a fighter, I was a hothead, I enjoyed it. Someone would have put a bullet in my head. My daughter wouldn't be here, my son wouldn't be here, you guys wouldn't be here, and obviously, the impact that I had in other people's lives wouldn't be there. So I appreciate you guys for coming, for being there, and letting me have an impact. I appreciate it. The reason
reason why I joined the Air Force, I'm not sure if everyone knows, but I do some motivational speaking professionally, and I talk about why I joined the Air Force. And the one person that inspired me to join the Air Force was a guardian ad litem, so like a big brother, and his name was Ron Barnett. And he was a pilot in the Air Force, and I used to go over to his house as he mentored me, and he had stuff from all over the world in his house. And I just was amazed to see things from Italy, from Japan, from Greece, from all over. And I'm going, wow, there's life outside LA? Who'd have known, you know? And he was the sole reason why I joined the Air Force 24 years ago. And my God, if he was here and alive today, I would thank him and kiss him, and he's changed my life. And obviously, he's helped me affect some positive in other people's lives. And going back to my theme, I think that's what we should do as people. If you're doing okay, then you should be helping someone else do better. Not okay, not just as good as you, better than you. If you can do that for other people, then you can look at yourself in a mirror and go, you know what? I contributed to this big thing we call humanity. Not America, not Greece, not your own little bubble, but to all of us who's connected to each other. We're from different walks of life, we're from different places, different countries, and we all have one connection no matter what, and that's our humanity. And so if I can leave you with anything, it's not the 24 years of service that I've given, it's that I'd love to see you guys connect with other people on a human level, on a real level, without care, not being selfish about it. We all connect selfishly, good, bad, or indifferent. Selflessly when you connect is what I'd like to say. That's how I live my life. And I have a pretty amazing life. I've had, and I continue will. And I think it's attributed to that one big characteristic. I care about everybody more than I care about myself. And you guys care about me more than I care about myself in return. It's cyclical. And it makes everybody better and more positive. So I'd like to thank you all for being here. From the bottom of my heart, thank you for taking the time out. Thank you for saying nice things about me. I appreciate everyone that's in this room and everyone that couldn't make it here. I appreciate it. So thank you again. And hopefully we'll see you soon.
Thank you. Thank you.
That was a heartfelt testimony. I appreciate that.
Thank you. I appreciate it.
My wife, Melinda.
How you doing? Pleasure to meet you. And once again, you're not in the way.
Okay. Well, I didn't know you were there, and I had been moving seats.
I just planned to come sit down and enjoy it, and then he's just like, I thought he wanted me to just hold his phone for him, so it's not, you know, distract him or anything. He's like, so could you just grab the stand on the other side and just go on some video? Really?
Yeah.
I need a paycheck for this.
Yeah. Or it's your afternoon gig. You know? I mean, after work, it's your.
It's varying things. I'm either working with my church or with my fraternity or my wife's sorority.
Okay.
Or doing some community service. Oh, you can walk through, man.
That's okay. No. Who's in charge so I can get my key so they can find
out? Yeah.
Yeah.
Oh, you're quite hard, though. Yeah. I'm just gonna.
Yes, I will be. Yeah, I'm gonna actually stop me and bring him along, get him a wife.
Yeah.
And then.
Oh,
yeah. Look. I wasn't there.
I deserve that.